No, no problem. I just want to confirm off the front, because you cut off when you said that. Did you say that it was Bush League, the story?
Bush League, absolutely. Okay. No, I think doing that is Bush League.
Correct.
I think it's a Bush League. I think it's a Bush League move. I think it's an amateur move. I think it's an arrogant move to use a rookie to help your position to motivate other players or to blackmail other players or to have something on other players, to have a young kid who is eager to play in the National Hockey League, who has all the desire in the world to play in Toronto, and you're pretty much blackmailing them to use them for dirt against the players that he's got to go out and play hard for, from the players that have to play hard for him. That is, that's one of the worst things I think I've ever heard. And, you know, as good of a coach as Babcock might have been and has been with championships and his record and all that stuff, that stoops way too low as for any coach in any league, in any level, to do something like that to a player. I feel awful for Mitch Marner because I know he's a heart and soul type guy. He's a team player. Obviously, he's one of the best players in the game. And to put him in that kind of situation, that's an awful way to start off a career.
JR, I think we're all of the same opinion that Mike Babcock believes his career as a head coach in this league isn't done. A story like this, however, how much damage could it do to those prospects?
Well, it could have a lot of damage, and I think it should have a lot of damage. I think those things should go, those unspeakable things should have serious consequences, whether that's being fined or whether that's being, you know, I think a deterrent to get another job. And, you know, is he the type of coach that can coach in the game today with the way the players are today? With the way, and I could still consider him an old school coach, where he's wears his heart in the sleeve in terms of his verbal confrontations, his ability to intimidate young players, I'll say this: what I hear from people that I know about him. Now, listen, anything I say, I'm not speaking on my interpretation of Mike Babcock and meeting him or his record. I go by what other people of very high value to me have told me. You know, maybe his ego is bigger than the team, bigger than the game, and it comes across to other players like that, that might be intimidated, especially young guys. Is he the type of player that can play in the game now, that can coach in the game? That's one question that's going to have to be answered, because you see all these young coaches coming in that are doing a great job, you know, that are changing kind of the way and the mentality that they're treating these young kids.
Well, that's what I was going to ask, Jared, just on that point right now. Like, the game is changing. The front offices are getting younger. The players are getting younger. The motivational tactics that maybe worked a couple decades ago seemingly have changed. Do you think for guys like Babcock to still stick around in this league, they need to evolve as well?
There's no question about it. And some of the best coaches in the game have been able to morph themselves and transcend themselves a little bit. I think, you know, if you look at how Joel Quenneville coaches, I think Joel Quenneville used to be a guy that used to intimidate the heck out of players and people. And his, you know, one of the second all-time leading winner as coaches go in the history of the game. But I think he's finding a way to maybe have a different way of getting across to players, a different message, and that's important. And I even think, even going further, John Tortorella has been able to, I think, to tone it down a little bit. He's been known as probably one of the hardest old school in your face coaches that we have in the game today. But I see him kind of toning down a little bit, especially over the last couple of years with, you know, with the way that the team's changed and intermingled in terms of losing guys and gaining guys.
JR, one last question on this topic, then we'll move on to some of the suspensions from the weekend. What do you believe of the opinion that some are holding when it comes to this story, saying it's gutless after the fact to be leaking stuff like this? If you had a problem with them, deal with it in the moment. Deal with it 3 years ago. Whoever leaked it, I have no idea who leaked it. But it's gutless now that he's gone. And it's not uncommon in sports nowadays, but it's gutless now he's gone to be floating something like this. How would you respond to that?
I think there's some validity to that. I would be one that would come right out and be, this is totally unacceptable. And you know, obviously there's a lot of fear in players today of coaches that have such power and such influence to, you know, to blackball them if something happens. I can understand that, but this is something that's way too, I think, off the radar to not bring it to somebody's attention and make sure that, you know, what is happening at our upper echelon of our team is dealt with and is not putting a wedge between our team, because that for sure could have, you know, would have put a wedge, and it is going to put a wedge if it happens again. And I don't think you should wait. I think it is kind of, you know, again, I'll call it, you know, you call it gutless maybe, but I can understand why, but it needed to be come out right away.
Let's move on to some controversy on the ice. Robert Bertuzzo suspended 4 games for a couple cross checks on Victor Arvidsson. The 4-game suspension, the ban, are you okay with that? Your thoughts on that?
Well, I think the NHL is trying to do a lot of things right now to try to send a message. You saw the message of the spitting with 3 games last week. Now Bertuzzo with that cross check from behind. These are the most dangerous things, I think, injury-prone penalties that you can have. When the guys aren't expecting it, they are near objects that can seriously do damage. And, you know, I've always been one. Listen, if you're going to take a penalty, be looking at them. You know, be looking face-to-face, be looking at the chest. This stuff from behind, I know it's a fast game. I know it's a, you know, spur-of-the-moment decision, but... Listen, anytime you see somebody's name or see somebody's number, there has to be some accountability. I'm a big Robert Bertuzzo fan. I hate to talk down on him because he's a very honest player, but he was not honest in this situation. He could have done serious damage to Arvidsson. And again, what's even worse, though, is the Kerfoot one with the cross check from behind and a forecheck at the goal line or anywhere near the boards. I hate this so much. I think a couple games for Kerfoot is totally not enough. I would have given them 10, 15 games, because this is the injury. This is the penalty that someone is going to get paralyzed again, or even worse, because people can die from neck injuries and head injuries that can be that you can get from these little pushes from behind 2 or 3 feet from the boards. It happened last year in the playoffs. You had Warren Fogle, who cross-checked TJ Oshie 3 feet from the boards. He broke his collarbone in 3 different places, was out for the rest of the playoffs, and he's lucky it was only his shoulder and his collarbone. I hate these. And you said gutless. If there's a gutless penalty in all of hockey, it is the cross checks 2 or 3 feet away from the boards, especially on a forecheck. That is the biggest lack of respect for a defenseman that already has a tough job of going back to get a puck. And then you do that. That Kerfoot should get 15, 20 games, in my opinion, for that one.
JR, strong stuff. I don't disagree with that. Thank you for powering through the beeping going on behind you the entire time. We love you for it.
It's crazy.
Let's do this again, man. Thank you.
All right, guys. Thanks again.